Hello everyone, my name is Kingsley Idoko and I want to welcome you to this video. In this video we want to discuss about the ESA, site-to-site VPN with the ESA, and then we want to look at a specific scenario where you have overlapping IPs between two remote sites. As you can see here, this is the topology we're going to be using. It's a little bit big and So you have two sites. Here is three sites, but the focus here is just two sites, right? Probably in subsequent video, we are also going to build site-to-site VPN between the Cisco and Juniper device. But for this section of the video, we just want to talk about the ASA. So here we have the London site, we have the New York site, London DC and New York data center. And we've been given the task to, you know, build site-to-site VPN between both sites. Now the challenge is, as you can see from the topology here, we are using the 10.0.0/16 subnet. And here we are using the 10.0.10.0/24 subnet. Now you definitely agree with me that there's an overlap, right? So there's an overlap between both sites. And so we need to figure out a way to make sure that, you know, users here or applications that are running here can talk to applications that are running on the other remote sites, right? So it's a kind of situations we face every day. You could be working for a company and then you need to talk to a different company. Maybe collaborate, or they have some kind of resources or applications that you need on your end. And so they said, you have to build site-to-site with us. And then when you want to build the site-to-site, you figure out, when they share their subnet, you figure out, oh, I have that subnet within my infrastructure. And so if I build a site, I can reach you because I always route internally. Because, you know, so those scenarios comes up all the time when you are building site to site with different companies or even within the same company from different sites, you know. You could say, well, Kingston, why not just change the subnet? Well, you can just, if this is your company and you have hundreds of devices and you don't want to, you can't really change the IPs, right? Otherwise, you're going to break a lot of things. You're going to be a lot of migrations. And so it's really not an option changing the IP. So you're left with figuring out a way to make it work, right? Like my manager will tell me, you have to find a way to make it work. And Cisco have an implementation. Well, not just Cisco. I don't know about other vendors, but there's something we call the identity NAT. Not identity NAT per se, there's a way you can create domain routes, IPs, and use it for this kind of scenario. So what I'm saying is, what we need to do, since both IPs are, there's an overlap, what we need to do is we need to come up with a second IP that we are going to use. So it has to be some kind of NATing that will come in place for the implementation to work. So what I'm trying to say is this. So since this subnet as a whole overlaps with this, so what we need to do is we need to figure out a way to NAT, we need to find a way to NAT this IP, maybe to a different IP, right? Similarly here, we're going to say when you're going out and this is your destination, we're going to NAT this entire subnet to a different IP, okay? So I think the best way to demonstrate it is just to do the implementation, and then probably it becomes clearer what I mean by doing the NATing. So yeah, so for the topology, we already have everything set up. I'm running ENG here. So as you can see, you have the ASA, they're already fired up. So we're just going to consult to them. So this is the London DC end, and then this is the New York DC end, and so we can just consult to one of the servers. These switches are really just let's come here. So the switches are just really layer 2 switches. In this case, I'm using Arista, and yeah. So here, You're just using the switches to do a VLAN suppression, so different traffic. I've already explained this in the previous videos where we discussed about active standby failover. So if you want to understand what is really happening here, you can go back to that video and watch how we implemented active standby failover for the ESA. So in this case, I'm going to be working on the primary because we're definitely sure, we are sure that whatever you do here, the traffic is going to be replicated to the secondary. So let me pull up my console. Sorry, I'm using multiple screen. So let me make the topology a bit bigger. Let's see. Okay, so push it this way. And then we can grab our console, make it a little smaller. So like I said, everything is really already up and running in terms of the connectivity here. So if I go to the primary ESA, so this is my primary ESA. So as you can see, there's really nothing, there's no much configuration here other than the IPs and the failover configs. And yeah, there's really not anything here. But you can see I can ping the internet. And if we also go to one of the servers, which is 10.0.0/20, that should be server one, which is this. I already configured an IP here. This IP is 10.0.0.20. So I can ping the gateway, which is 10.0.0.254. And I can also ping the internet. Right, so we're good here. So as you can see, we already configured some kind of NAT in here. So there's already NAT configuration configured here. Just basic, you know, source NAT, NATing the entire slash system to the public interface, right? So if we also go to the other network, too big. So this is the other network we have here. Need to make it smaller a bit, yeah. So for the other network, which is the New York data center, this is the firewall as well. There's really no configuration here. Just ping to the internet, right? And of course the LAN interface, which is J0/0, it's 10.0.254, and this is 10.10.252, so you should be able to ping that as well. Ping to 10.0.10.252. I need to check if the IP listed there. So this is New York server. Fconfig. Okay, so it's a wrong. Sorry. The IP should be 252, so it's the wrong IP I have here. So let me just correct that. 10.0.10.252. The netmask is 255. This is Tiny Linux. And then sudo route add default gateway. I think that should already be there. So let's ping to 10.0.10.254. Yeah, so I have reachability and I should also be able to ping the internet. So there's no default gateway. So route add default gateway should be 10.0.10.254. Need to use sudo. Sudo. So I should now be able to ping the internet. So we're good. Of course, here there's really nothing for the NAT configuration. This is what we have. So I'm just NATing inside to outside, and we're NATing the entire /24 to the public interface. The public interface is 0 interface 0/1 1.30. This is what as the IP here too. For the London DCN, the public interface is, hope there's no mess up here. So show run interface g0/1, right? I think that's the public interface. No, so it's a sub interface. So show run interface g0/0.20. So here's 1.30, and here should be 1.10. So there's a mistake here. So let's correct that for the loading end. So here should be 1.10. Okay, so having that now, the first thing we need to do is to check the stretchability between the two ASA. Like I said, the IP for this, for the London DCNN is 1.30, and here is 1.10. So let's do a ping 192.168.1.30. Yeah. So from this end as well, we can test ping to 192.168.1.10. So there's reachability at least over the public internet between both devices. This is just a virtual environment, so it's not really. Yes, they have internet really, but I mean these are not really actually public IPs. That's my point. Okay, so let's get started with the configuration of site-to-site VPN. So I think the steps are here. VPN setup, site-to-site steps. So what we need to do here is, I think I can make this bigger now. Why is it hard to drag? Let's just continue. So here's these are the steps for the site-to-site VPN. We already configured our interface, so we need to create our IKE policy. So what if there's enough time, we can do IKE v1, IKE v2, and see the difference. So we create our transform sets, we create our tunnel groups, and yeah, just really. So let's start with crypto. So let's start with this. Let's enable the so we're just gonna say crypto ICCAM enable outside. So it's not, I don't think it's ICCAM. I think it's IKE v1. So this should be IKE v1. So we've enabled it on the public interface. So we can also do the same thing on the other end. Right, so we know we're done with that. The next thing is to create our IKE policy, which is this, right? So it's not ICCAM. So anywhere you see ICCAM, you just replace it with IKE v1. IKE v1, policy 10, and then we can just grab everything here. I think there's the security, there's the lifetime. If you don't specify it, I think the default is this. So show run crypto. It should be here. So we already have this configured. So I'm just going to replicate this on the other end as well. So everything is just so we know everything is the same and we don't have to worry troubleshooting. The next step is to create the transform set, right? So we can just use this. This is just a lab, and I want to make some few changes here, just give it a different name. So here I call it I think it should be 128. Let's use 256 here, and then I also want to change the name to, let's just call it our sets, and then it's not going to be so let's just type it crypto IPsec IKE v1 transform sets our sets, and encapsulation be ESPAS. Let's see. No. So ESA should be AES. Yeah, so this one I'm looking for. 256, and then ESP SHA-1 HMAC. So we're done with that. The next thing is to create our access list. I think I'm going to come back to this access. No, we have to create the access list. Otherwise, we will not be able to. So for the access list talks about the interesting traffic, right? Which traffic are we interested in? Now, the traffic we're interested in is 10.0.0.10 to 10.0.10.0/24, and here's the /16. Those are the two subnets we're interested, right? So we are saying if traffic is coming and the destination is this network, we want you to what? Encrypt it and pass it through the IPsec, the site-to-site tunnel, right? But in this case, the two IPs overlaps, which is what we said. And so what we need to do, we need to create more like a hold on. We need to create a dummy route, right? So in this case, what we need to do is, I'm going to use 192 dot, yeah, we can use 192. 192.168.10.0/24, right? So what I'm saying is for the 10.0.0.0/16, right? I'm going to NAT this to this route here. Let me see if I can make it bigger. Okay, so what we are saying is this. So for this network, if the route is going from the London DC to the New York DC, what we want to do is, if it's coming from this subnet, we want to NAT it to this subnet. That is really what you do in situations where you have overlapping IPs. Similarly, on this end, so I'm just going to see if I can duplicate this. Similarly, for the 10.0.10.0/24, we can access say 10.0.10.0/24. So we're going to say if it's coming from this prefix, we also want to NAT it to just another IP, which is which is .20. Why am I finding it hard to edit? So 10.20.0/24. Okay. So this is really what we need to do, right? So we need to NAT this. This is a /16. We might not be interested in the entire subnet, right? So I think we should limit it to a /24. Not every part of the network we want, you know. So we are just going to cover the /24 from here. Let's say this is the subnet. Of course, that's what we are using here. And so we are going to say if anything is coming from this subnet, want to NAT it to this IP and then go as it goes out to the New York DC. Similarly, if any user is coming or any user or application or whatever is coming from this subnet, we want to NAT it to this IP. Now what you end up having is IPs from different subnet, right? So the overlap is fixed with this kind of implementation. So what that mean is so the access list we need to create now, we'll be looking out for these IPs. Because when you look at the hierarchy of how the different, I don't know how to describe it now. What comes first is the NAT network address translation, right? If you do your packet tracer, you see there's the NAT translation. So yes, you want to check, oh, should I NAT or not NAT? So once there's a NAT, before it gets to the stage where the access list, there's a match for the access list, the IPs would have changed. So if we are matching this, as at the time the access list kicks in for the checks, the IP would have already been translated to these IPs. So the access list we need to create need to look out for these IPs, not the actual internal IPs that we are using. So what that means is the access list we will create. So I'm just going to say access lists. Let's call it our VPN access list. So we're just going to say permit, right? Now what we need to permit these two subnets, right? I prefer to create an object for just the subnet. So I'm going to say object network. So this is what we are using, so let's bring this one here so that we don't get it confused. So we are on the London firewall, right? This is the London firewall. So this is what we need to create. So I'm going to say network object 192.168.10.0/24, right? So the subnet is going to be 192.168.10.0/24. Okay. Of course, we also need to create the second one, jet network, which is 192.168.20.0/24. You can give it a different name, it doesn't have to be that name, that's it's arbitrary. 20.0/255.255.0. So we have both objects created now, so we cannot create the access list. So I call it our VPN access list. So what we now need to do is to permit. So permit if it's coming from this network, right? And it's going to this network, right? Permit IP, sorry. We need to add the objects. Yeah. So if I say show run access list, yeah. So this is our access list that says if you say traffic coming from 10.0/24 and it's going to 20.0/24, which is this other end, then go ahead and match it. Okay. So we need to do the same for the other end. So I'm just going to see if we can replicate. Show run objects. These are the two subnets, right? So I'm just going to replicate it on this other end as well. And yeah, so we've created the object and then the access list. So it's going to be the same access list, but it's just going to be like a reverse. So come here, put it, don't commit. So we need to take this part out. And then put it in the end. So it's going to be objects, right? So show run access list. So yeah, so if it's coming from 20.0 and it's going to 10.0, go ahead and match. We also created the transform set here, so just let's just replicate it here. Where is our transform set? You can just say sure crypto. So this is our transform set that we already created. So let's replicate it here. So okay, so the next thing is the profile, and let's go back to the steps again. The next thing is the tunnel group, right? So on the primary, it's pointing to 192.168.10.0, right? So it's good to actually use a notepad to make life easy. So let me see if I can bring up a notepad here. So this is, we need to grab this. I mean, let's just grab everything here. Makes it easy. So just put it here. And then the IP we're interested is what? 192.168.10.0. So I'm just going to say 192.168.1.10. Sorry. So just copy and replicate here. And the password, we can just change it to Cisco 123. Don't do that in production, of course. And then for the crypto map, So in this case, we are just going to be matching that access list we already created. Where is the access list? We called it this. So here we'll match the access list. And this is the IP. And the transform set which we've created, we called it our transform set here. So this is it. And this is a transform set. Says reverse route is really not important, but you can leave it there. We can take this out. Just the description. So I believe everything here is correct. If that is the case, so let's just put them in. Hope we don't get any error. Oh, let's copy it again. Config T. Yeah, so no error. So if I say show run crypto, so we should have everything. So we're matching the access list, we're pointing to the remote peer, we're matching the transform set. Reverse route is just a way of saying, okay, if I receive the route through this path, I'm going to automatically jet into the routing table. You really don't need that since we already have like this default route that points to the outside interface. So this is also going to create a static route pointing to the outside interface. So we need to do the same for the other end, which is the London end, which is this end. So the IP is really what is going to change. So the IP is 1.30. So we just need to say change the IP to 30. So if everything is good, we should have reachability on both ends. Right, so okay, show run crypto. So we have our transform set. We should show run crypto. We should also have, that's our transform set. We're matching it here, and then we also have our, of course, the policy. And so with this, I believe everything should be fine. So except the NAT that we need to also work on, right? Now we need to do, it's not NAT exempt, but we need to say, so what we need to do here is this. We need to say if the traffic is coming from this server, right, and it hits the access list, right? So first thing we need to do is to say NAT this IP, where is it? NAT this subnet to this subnet. Okay, NAT the 10.0.0/24 to the 192.10.0/24. Similarly, on this other end, we need to tell the ASA, if it's coming from this subnet, go ahead and NAT it to this IP, and then after that, the access list matches it, and then it takes it through the tunnel. Now to configure that is also very straightforward. You just need to say NAT. Of course, the interface here is the inside, so we just need to say config T NAT from inside to outside. Right, and then we're going to say source, in this case it's going to be static. It's static NAT, not dynamic, because this is not it's not port address translation, it's a one-to-one translation, right? So what that means is 10.0.0.1 we map to what, 192.168.10.1. okay, so it's a one-to-one translation that you're doing here. So we're going to say do we already have the objects? I think so. So, but let's just show on objects. Yeah, so we have, so the object we have is slash 16, but I want to do it for this slash 24. right? We're just trying to reduce the size. So I'm gonna say 24 subnet is 10.0.0.0.0.255.255.25.0. Yeah, so should run objects network. It's actually network, so it should give me. So we have our /24. So I'm going to say here now that NAT inside to outside. Source is static. Do we need to specify the object? So here you don't need to specify the object. So I'm just going to call the object group that we created. So if it's coming from, where's the /24? Okay, this. So if it's coming from this /24, we want to NAT it to this subnet. Okay. Right. And then the destination is going to remain unchanged, right? So destination also static. Don't NAT the destination, just leave it this way. Okay, yeah, that's all we need to do. Should run NAT. So we have the NAT configuration running. We're saying if it's coming from the /24, NAT to this IP for the destination, it should remain unchanged. Yeah, this is where the identity NAT comes in, where you are like NATing yourself to yourself. So there's really nothing going on there. So it's the same thing we need to do for the other end. So let's go to this end as well. So show run NAT, show run object network. So we have the two subnet, but okay, so we have everything we need here, so we can just go ahead and say NAT inside to outside. And source is static. And so we're going to say if it's coming from the LAN, which is this, I hope we understand. This is the LAN, right? So I'm going to say if it's coming from this subnet. And we want to NAT it to what now? The 192/24, and also destination source is static. And so the destination is this. So the destination is going to remain unchanged. So NAT destination, NAT it to itself. That's what it means. Sure on NAT. Cool, right? Now we need to be careful of the hierarchy. You see this after auto, this is like, okay, if all the NAT doesn't match, then default to this. We also need to do the same thing on this end. So in this case, you see this is on top of this. In terms of the hierarchy, because if you see show NAT, you see this is number one and this is number two. So if you do your packet tracer, you see this is going to match and it will not match this, right? Because this is saying if it's coming from this whole subnet, just NAT it to the public interface. This will break the VPN. So we need to change this. It's wrong this way. So we need to say no this. And then instead, we need to put it as a... at the bottom. So that's what this command does. So, but this is wrong. We're not using this. So we just copy spot and then we can match our /24, which is this, and then we can say interface show run NAT. So yeah, so I believe we are good with the implementation now. If everything is correct, the tunnel should come up. So show crypto IV1 SA. There's no session. I think we need to initiate a session. If also say show VPN section DB LAN to LAN. No active session. So show run tenant group, just to be sure we never check this. So everything is fine here. Show run crypto. Everything should be good. Now, if we want to test, how do we test? Just a sec. Now we definitely know that this 10.0.0.20 is going to map to what here? It's going to map to so this is 19, this is 10.0.10.252, right? And remember, you are doing one-to-one nothing, right? Static nothing, really, right? So what that means is, if we want to get to 10.0.10.252, the actual IP we should be going to is 192.168.20.252. Let's see if that works. Let's see if that is right. So I need to stop this ping. Can I still ping the internet? I should still be able to ping the internet. Okay, something is not right. Oh, this is the firewall. No, it's not the firewall. This is the London DC. So can I still ping the gateway? Four. Okay, so I think we so let me see. I have config, the subnet is /24, right? But I don't think so the subnet is /24, and let's come here and say show run interface 0.0.20. Here the subnet is, sorry, the 10 is the LAN interface. So the 254, so everything should work. We should be able to ping. Let's see, ping to 10.0.0.20. I can't, so let's be sure it's not a problem with the switch. Let me just check. Something is wrong with the switch. So something is wrong with the switch. So I'm just going to pause the video and probably restart the switch. The switch just looks like it crashed. Yeah, so I'm just going to pause the video and reboot, and then we'll be right back. Okay, guys, my apologies. The switch crashed, and so I had to pause the video and then try to fix it. It's a virtual environment, and you know, these things happen. I mean, like, even the real world switches crashes a lot. Okay, so, but it's back up, and the point is going through now, right? So because if I go to the firewall, I should not be able to ping 10.0. Let's go to the main topology. So let's go to I can ping my the server behind, which is 10.0.20.0.20, and it too should be able to ping me. That's the London server. Yeah, so I should be able to ping my gateway now, .254. Right now, so I was trying to explain something before, that if you look at this NAT, right? Now let's go to the firewall. Show run NATs, and so what I was saying before was that this NAT is a one-to-one mapping, right? So what that means is, if you are trying to reach an IP here, let's say I'm trying to reach 10.0.10.252, right? Remember, this IP is NATed to the 20.0/24, right? So it's 1-to-1. So what that means is 10.1 here translate to 20.1, 10.2 translate to 20.2, right? To be honest, it's not that I read it somewhere, but just from the test, that's where I realized it's actually a 1-to-1 mapping. And besides, here it says static, right? It's a static NAT, it's a one-to-one NAT, right? So for the entire slash 24, each IP maps to a different IP here. So similarly here, right? If I'm trying to reach the 10.0.0.20, what that translates to here will be 191.10.20. If you think there's a lie, let's try it. So let's even be sure that the tunnel is up, right? We can initiate the tunnel by doing the ping. And if I go to this guy, so I'm going to say, now I want to do a ping to 192.168.20.252, right? So let's see. Oh my God, this is nice. So let's come here and say show crypto IPv1 SA. So of course we are in, I think this is main mode. I think that's what it means, active. And I can say show VPN section DB, filter, no, we're just gonna say site to site. All right, so the tunnel has been off for about 4 minutes. So this is where you can check if there's a problem with the transmit and receive. So we can see there's traffic for transmit. There's also the receive transmit. So there's the receive packet, I mean. So for IPv1, so I can come here and say show crypto, if you want to check VIX2, IPv, show crypto IPsec, it used to be show crypto IPsec SA. Yeah, so this is the, you see packets are being encrypted and decrypted. You can check the security associations for, so this is for outbound, there's the SPI, and this is for the inbound, right? So as far as we know, the tunnel is up. So currently we are pinging from this server to this server. Now, just to prove to you that it's a one-to-one mapping, I'm going to change the IP of this server to something else. So this is New York server. Currently the IP is ifconfig is 10.10. So let's just put it 10.10.100, let's say. So I'm going to say sudo ifconfig 10.0.10.100. And the netmask is going to be 255.255.0, right? So the IP has changed. You have to always add the sudo. What does it say? Say what? Oh, I didn't specify the link. Ethernet 0. Okay. So now you're going to see it's going to stop. Yeah, just stopped because the IP changed. So we need to, if we want to ping that server now, we need to change the IP again to ping to 192.168.20.100. It should work. It should work. I hope let's see, IF config. Yeah, so here it should be 191. Say yes, 20.100. Here was what? Here is 10.10.100. So the IP we should be pinging is 191.20.100. So let's be sure. Let's go back to this server. I like this troubleshooting. So ping to 10.0.10.254. Yeah, so can I ping the internet? The default gateway is out. I know something was wrong. Route add default gateway 10.0.10.254. So when you change the IP, does it take the default gateway out? That's strange. Sudo. Okay, so with that, I should be able to ping it now. Yeah, good. All right, so the point I'm just trying to make is that it's a one-to-one mapping, right? So like I explained, so if the IP is 10 dot, so if this IP is 10.0.0.20, and we know we are NATing it to this IP, so we need to hit 10.20 here. All right, so we can also try it from here, from the other end. So I want to ping 192.168, ping to 192.168.10.20. Yeah, so Everything is good. And the last thing I just want to add is we want to change the thumbnail. We want to enable both Hike V1 and Hike V2, but of course the video is already way too long. So in the next section, we're just going to leave the configuration, then we're just going to enable the Hike V2, and we see there's really no difference. Of course, Hike V2 give you more encryption, gives you more keys, so it's much more secure, because you can specify multiple keys at the same time. So we're just going to modify the configuration a bit for Hike V2, and that will be in the next video. So if you like this video, I want you to subscribe so that when I make more videos, you'll be the first to see them. And of course, our focus is not just certifications, it's really real world scenarios is what we try to work through. These are some of the challenges we face on our day-to-day work as network engineers, and that's why sometimes if I think of anything in my head, I just come and then practice it and see it work, then I also try to make a video about it. So if you have anything in mind you want me to talk about as well, you can also drop it on the comment section, and also hit the subscribe button and the like and share. Thank you. See you in the next video.